The daily word for Sunday, June 30th, is world peace. Affirming the divinity of all the world's people, I envision world peace. Peace is meant for every person of every faith in every land. Today, I look beyond the news of the world, reports of strife and conflict, even the agitation and unforgiveness in my own heart, and find the peace of God. I believe the desire for lasting peace is within each person's heart. In prayer, I affirm this truth and envision this desire growing stronger among the world's people until peace can no longer be denied. It is our shared destiny to believe in peace. When each person wants for all people what they want for themselves, harmony will blanket the earth. I affirm the peace I wish for myself is dawning in the hearts of others. In prayer, I see them safe and secure in the heart of God, forever at peace. Now may the Lord of peace himself give you peace at all times and in all ways. The Lord be with all of you. That's from the Thessalonians 3:16.
Thank you, Beverly. What a beautiful reading for today. We are now going to say our statement of being. Say it with real intention. God is all, both invisible and visible. One presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. I am an individualized expression of God. I am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. And that is the truth for each and every one of us. It's time for our meditation. So I'm going to invite you to just become relaxed wherever you are. Put your feet on the floor, whatever might be in your hands, take it out of your hands. So let's, if you're comfortable, close your eyes and take that holy breath. That centering breath. Become still and follow your breath. Follow your breath within. To that gentle, peaceful center of your being. Gently shift your thoughts to thoughts of truth, releasing, clearing away any clouds of doubt or concern. And in that empty, open, receptive space, just listen. Just relax into that presence, that power that is within you. And let's rest. Rest in that silence for just a few moments. Thank you. know that you are one with all that is. You are peace. Breathe that in. Embrace it. You are love. That is the truth of you, the core of your being. Let that love grow and expand within you. That presence, that power of God is within you, guiding you in wisdom and in love. You are one with all that is. God's healing, holy presence is within you, speaking to you. And gently become aware of the gratitude that you have. And embrace this affirmation. I am grateful, grateful for the truth that is being revealed in me. And so it is. Take that breath and become aware of the love and oneness that we share.
What is America to me? A name, a map, or a flag I see? A certain word, democracy. What is America to me? The house I live in, a plot of earth, the street, the grocer and the butcher, and the people that I meet, the children in the playground, the faces that I see, all races and religions, that's America to me. The place I work in, the worker at my side, the little town or city where my people lived and died, the howdy and the handshake, the air of feeling free, the right to speak my mind out, that's America to me. Things I see about me, the big things and the small, the little corner newsstand and the house a mile tall, the wedding and the churchyard, the laughter and the tears, the dream that's been a-growing for more than 200 years. The town I live in, the street, the house, the room, the pavement of the city, or a garden all in bloom, the church, the school, the clubhouse, the million lights I see, and especially the people, that's America.
to me.
I'm so happy to be here, to see those beautiful smiling faces. It's like, it's just wonderful. Thank you. Thank you for your smiles. My talk is titled, From Revolution to Evolution, Celebrating Interdependence Day. We are all interdependent. No one is a self-made man or woman. We are all in this together. I just got back from a wonderful visit with my brother, Paul, and my sister-in-law, Terry. They live in Concord, Massachusetts. And I thought, how interesting that I was invited to do this talk on Independence Day, and that I am at the birthplace of two movements, the birthplace of the revolution and the birthplace of another movement that I'll talk about in a moment. So here are some interesting facts about Concord, Massachusetts. The first battle of the Revolutionary War, I knew I was going to trip on that one, the Revolutionary War, took place at the Old North Bridge. That skirmish became known as the Shot Heard Round the World. It happened April 19th, 1775, nearly 250 years ago. So that's my little talk about the revolution. But what about the evolution? Concord is known not only as the birthplace of the American Revolution, but as the birthplace of the Transcendentalist movement. Ralph Waldo Emerson and Henry David Thoreau both lived there. Emerson, a prolific writer, was vitally important to the development of this movement. Some even think of Emerson as the father of New Thought. In the book, The Unity Movement, by Neil Dahl, the Fillmores have said, all students of metaphysics should read Emerson, and no metaphysical student should be without his work. When I'm in Concord, I always go to the Sleepy Hollow Cemetery, and I go up to Author's Ridge, and within just a few steps is Emerson's grave, Thoreau's grave, and Louisa May Alcott. And I sit there and I meditate, and I hope to get some inspiration from Emerson and Thoreau and Louisa May Alcott as well. So my point is, I'm suggesting when all the fireworks, the barbecues, the picnics are done, we are left with a task. I've been mentioning birth, the birth of the revolution, the birth of the Transcendentalist movement. But once we, as a parent, we know once we birth somebody, the job is not over, far from it. Those who have been parents know that there are years, years of work, years of guidance, years of growth, sometimes years of tears, and there's years of support and learning. But we also need to grow ourselves up and to put into practice the principles that we know. 1 Corinthians chapter 13, verse 11 says, when I was a child, I spoke as a child. But when I became a man, and I'm going to add, or a woman, or a grown-up, I put away childish things. It just might be time for us to put away childish things, to evolve. One of the things a young child says frequently is, "Mine, mine, mine." But in unity, aren't we supposed to be all about oneness? It isn't just a platitude, I hope. How many of us talk about oneness, but when we talk about immigrants or members of the opposing political party or people who look or act different, we may discover that we change our harmonious tune? Can we honestly say that we embrace those of different religions or sexual orientations? Or do we talk about separation, differences, the other? These thoughts of separation, of differences, they stem from fear of lack, fear of our own belief that we are not enough. I realize that it's so easy to become entrenched in childhood beliefs, what our parents taught us, to stick with that status quo, to not rock the boat. But we only have one now. Now is our moment of change, not tomorrow. How many of you recall the three C's from Dale Carnegie? Anybody? Oh, yay! It was, don't criticize, condemn, or complain. Some people wore bracelets. I don't have a Dale Carnegie one, but I've got some bracelets on here. And every time you had one of those thoughts, like complain or criticize or anything negative, you had to switch the bracelet. Some would even snap that bracelet, ow, you know, like punish yourself for having that negative thought. So there are a whole plethora of bracelets. There is the Peace Begins With Me bracelet. There was the What Would Jesus Do bracelet. My day, if I wore bracelets all the time, would be consumed with switching wrists back and forth from one to the other. But the basic premise that I believe those bracelets held was to become mindful, to inch slowly, however slowly, towards becoming more non-judgmental, more loving, more of a peaceful presence in the world. I'm a believer of the 100th monkey effect. How many of you know about the 100th monkey effect? Oh, wow, that's a lot of you. It's a kind of a tipping point, reaching critical mass, where a new behavior is spread rapidly without explanation. Now, the story behind the 100th monkey, and I'm doing this very general, is that there were monkeys on this island, and they started washing their fruit. They had no contact with monkeys anywhere else. But when they reached that tipping point, that 100th monkey, monkeys all over the world started washing their fruit. At least that's the story. That's what I'm saying. So it's that tipping point. We inch forward slowly, hoping to reach critical mass. I'm part of a Holy Moments weekly Zoom group. Some of you here, I know, have read the Holy Moments book. And sometimes I wonder, why in the world would I, week after week, get up early, do my reading, and listen and share my thoughts? Why would anybody get up that early? We get up that early to make that holy shift, to not feel alone, to support others on this journey, and to be supported in growth. Change can be messy. It's difficult. When I look around, it's easy to notice discord, lack of harmony, lack of peace. Just turn on the news. There's discord, violence, discontentment, disrespect. But there's hope. We can change that. We can make another choice. It's all about our free will and choosing. We can ask to see things differently, to move from who we think we are or who others say we are to who we know we are, to be the change that the world so desperately needs. Yes, there are times when I will make mistakes, major ones. And when I have to move that imaginary bracelet, I hope that I can learn from those mistakes, those judgments. I believe compassionate self-awareness and gentle guidance are needed for growth and change. Where do we find that guidance? There might be clues in some of my favorite quotes from Emerson. I have a little book, actually I have two little books, that whenever I come across a really cool quote, I write it down in my little book. And so I went through my book to say, look for quotes from Emerson or Thoreau. This quote, for some reason, I had written down 5 times in my little book, and I try not to repeat myself. So this quote is really powerful. What lies behind us and what lies before us are tiny matters compared to what lies within us. I'm going to repeat that. What lies behind us and what lies before us are tiny matters compared to what lies within us. So the past doesn't really matter anymore. We can't change it. It's behind us. But we can let the past go. We can't know the exact future, so right now, we can go within and ask for guidance. And when we go within, what's within us? Those 12 powers: faith, strength, wisdom, love, power, imagination, understanding, just to name a few. Zeal, I always like zeal. We have the ability to let go. And when we can call forth these gifts. And when we do, we are changed, energized, and empowered. Emerson also wrote, "The highest revelation is that God is in every man." Everybody. Are we living our lives this way? The answers are within us, each and every one of us. We just said our statement of being earlier. God is all, both invisible and visible. One presence, one mind, one power is all. This one that is all is perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. I am an individualized expression of God. I am ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. This statement of being applies to all of us. We are ever one with this perfect life, perfect love, and perfect substance. We need to remember this in every encounter that we have. We hold these truths to be self-evident. My brother Paul brought to my attention the meaning of the word conquered. Concord. I say it 2 different ways because those people in Massachusetts say it differently too. Concord means harmony, peace, agreement, compatibility. It stems from the root concourse, agreeing or being together. And core, which means heart. So in essence, it's talking about joining our hearts together. Isn't that oneness? The oneness that we share, oneness that we talk about and hopefully demonstrate in unity in our lives? Emerson also said, "What you are speaks so loud, I cannot hear what you are saying." In other words, our actions have to be in accord with our principles, in alignment with the truth that we claim to embrace. How do we demonstrate that? How do we help that baby thought grow into a compassionate adult? By being open to that guidance, by encouraging and supporting growth. The focus is not on fixing others, but by being a loving presence to ourselves and those we encounter. Prayer. Prayer certainly is one way. Here's another fabulous Emerson quote. "Prayer is the contemplation of the facts of life from the highest point of view." So pray. Pray not to God, but from the awareness, the realization of the oneness that we share. Pray from the highest consciousness. Prayer, the revealing word tells us, is more than supplication, which means begging or pleading with God. It's an affirmation of truth with a capital T. We become still and we think about the inexhaustible resources of infinite mind. Infinite mind, inexhaustible resources. And then when we hear that still small voice, that guidance that will speak to us, we listen, we hear, we move forward, and we evolve. This movement forward may not mean taking the easy road or going along with the crowd. Here's another Emerson quote. "Do not go where the path may lead you. Go instead where there is no path and leave a trail." Be a trailblazer. Lead the way. Be the light. One last Emerson quote. "Oh man, there is no planet, sun, or star that could hold you if you but knew who you are. You are limitless. Why would we bother with the petty things of life when we all have a great calling? When we all have unique gifts to share? Let's let go of those things that slow us down, that baggage that we drag through life, that unforgiveness, the petty grudges. Let's let it go. Let's keep moving forward. Evolution can be seen as a pattern of movement, moving forward, maybe spiraling upward, but rising. We don't have to go it alone, because we are never alone, and we can be a support to each other. Being part of a living, loving community can make the difference." I'm switching to Thoreau now. Henry David Thoreau wrote, "We must learn to reawaken and keep ourselves awake, not by mechanical means, but by an infinite expectation of the dawn. Isn't that beautiful? We must learn to reawaken and keep ourselves awake by an infinite expectation of the dawn. Reawaken. That means that we were awake and we all fell asleep. Let's wake up. Rise up in consciousness. Let's shine our light. Light is the symbol of wisdom and enlightenment. Keep expecting. Keep envisioning. Keep moving forward, doing what is only yours to do. That small community in Concord birthed two movements and had a lasting positive impact. This community, Unity East, can do the same. Pray. Go into that silence and ask what is yours to do. Then pray for the strength to follow through and expect great things. As Thoreau wrote, if one advances confidently in the direction of his dreams and endeavors to live the life he has imagined, he will meet with success unexpected in common hours. My prayer for all of us is to dream big, to pray with confidence. And if we do, we will create a world of love, of compassion, and peace. But we can't do it alone. We can't do it independently. We have to do it together. One more quote from Philippians chapter 4, verse 8. Finally, my brothers and sisters, whatever is true, whatever is noble, whatever is right, whatever is pure, whatever is lovely, whatever is admirable, if anything is excellent or praiseworthy, think about these things. Happy Interdependence Day. Thank you. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not in temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. And now is your opportunity to be part of that flow, to be part of that flow of giving and receiving. So take that image of gifting in your hand, in your head too, because your church is much more than just financial giving. There is the choir, all the people who donate their talents and their time. But let's say our prayer for our tithes. Divine love, through me, blesses and multiplies all that I have, all that I give, and all that I receive. Joyfully and richly. For the universe is my source, and abundance is my nature. And that's the truth. Thank you.
Maybe.
Light of God surrounds us, love of God enfolds us, the power of God protects us, and the presence of God watches over us. Wherever we are, God is, and all is well.